What's up? Good to see you guys today. Thank you for making Obi-Wan a part of your weekend. My name is Kris. I'm one of the pastors, and it's my privilege to share the message with you today. So let me just ask a question off the start. How many of you have had life throw you a curveball? Everybody raise your hand, because all of us have been there. My wife and I have been through several. Let me just share a couple with you. So we're going about life, thinking things are good, and then just gonna go meet my boss like typical, and he's visibly upset, not at me, but because he's about to tell me, sorry, Kris, we can't afford you full time anymore. Curveball, right out of the blue. We had two kids at that point. It was crazy. Curveball. Here's another one. This has happened to us a couple times, that dreaded phone call about losing a loved one suddenly. It's like, what just happened? This person was so healthy. How did that happen? Curveball. You ever been there? Where life hit, threw you a curveball and life left you in a daze. You know, it doesn't even need to be the big things the examples that I just mentioned. It could be little disappointments or little regrets that add up over time, and it can leave us discouraged. One of the reasons the holidays can be so hard for some is because it's a magnification a lot of times of what we're already feeling. It's a reminder of that. Oh, another year's gone by. I didn't know I was going to be at this place still. Regret, disappointment, tragedy. The holidays can even bring back. You remember those awesome childhood memories like the Peanuts, Charlie Brown's Christmas, and just all those cool things, Grandma's house. But when you're in a daze, you're yearning for something that you can't have back. And so this thing called the holidays that's supposed to be a reminder to focus on Jesus becomes a magnification of what we're already feeling. Life in a daze. Pastor Julian encouraged us last week to not lose focus, which is so good, because you can't prepare well if you're not focused. And here's the thing, you can't focus well if you're in a daze. Have you ever been around someone that's daydreaming? You're like, hello, anybody home up there? Knock, knock, McFly, where are you? Right? They're just somewhere else. Thankfully, you don't have to remain in a daze. So for our remaining time, I want to talk with you about some things you can do, that we can do, to snap out of the daze so that you can continue to prepare for Christmas, which we all know really is Jesus. Truthfully, these things can be help you during any season that you need to snap out of a daze, because the Bible is applicable in every season. Can I get an amen on that, right? So let's go to the Bible. There's this angel named Gabriel, and he appears before a person named Mary, and then he greets her, which I'm very appreciative that Gabriel did that. Could you imagine if an angel just popped in your room right now? You'd freak out, right? I don't care if the angel said, poof, you won $1 million. And you would be like, ah, and you'd run out of the room. Or you'd say, get out, one of them. This is what's happening to Mary right now. Anyways, the angel tells her that God is pleased with her and that the Lord is with her. You would think that Mary would be happy about that. But listen to a response in Luke 1. You can follow along on the screen. You can take notes. You can look at your cell phone, your paper Bible, whatever is easier for you. It says this, Mary was very upset. Mary was very upset because of his words. He just said good things. She wondered what kind of greeting this could be. Why was Mary upset? The angel had just said positive things to her. Maybe Mary had this kind of syndrome, like, when's the shoe going to drop? Like, oh, God, you're pleased with me, but I'm going to die tomorrow. right? Or the angel's going to tell me that the Lord's with you, but you're going to lose your house next month, right? It's like, no, that's not what happened, but she was upset, and it got me thinking how often we can be the same. We have a good, loving God, but we're afraid to hear what God might say. We're bothered by, God knows all my skeletons in the closet. What will he say to me? So what would the angel actually say? He actually says this in Luke 1. But the angel said to her, circle this if you need it. Do not be afraid. Mary, God is very pleased with you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son. You must call him Jesus. Number one, if you're going to be someone that snaps out of a daze so that you can continue to prepare for Christmas, which prepares your heart for Jesus, number one, refuse to let fear take over. Refuse to let fear take over. How many of you get secondhand embarrassment? You feel other people's feelings, right? My daughter can be like that. So she just has this sense of what someone's feeling. She can get secondhand embarrassment. It's probably why she doesn't like going a lot of places with me, right? But I was like, what's wrong? You're like, Daddy. Like, I breathe wrong. She's like, Daddy, you know? But when she was younger, she even had that when she was younger. And I must have been having a moment where I wasn't doing well. I don't remember if it was a season or just a moment. And I remember her walking over to me, looking at me and saying this, it's okay, Daddy. It's Corey. You're supposed to go, oh, come on. Man, let's pray. No, I'm just kidding. I'm teasing. You know, I think that Jesus wants to look some of you in the eyes and say, it's okay. I'm here. I got this. I know you don't know what's going to happen, but you don't need to be afraid. You don't need to. One of Jesus' names actually means God with us, just like we sang. He's with us, church. He's with us. He's right beside you. See, during times where life has thrown me curveballs, sometimes fear would win, and sometimes I would choose the peace that God had for me. But I'll tell you, when I chose fear, I stayed in a daze or my daze got deeper. Have you ever been there? Why? Because fear is crippling and it's paralyzing. How are we going to pay for this? Will this person ever forgive me? Will I ever be able to trust that person again? Will my marriage always be like this? Will school always be this hard? Will my kids ever listen again? Right? Or more broadly, will life always look this bleak? When fear's knocking on the door, let the angel's message reassure you. Do not be afraid. Do not. And why can we trust that statement? Because God is with us through Jesus. He'll take care of you. So you want to snap out of the daze? Refuse to let fear take over. Let's flip the script for a minute. Could you imagine being Mary's fiance, Joseph? I promise I didn't cheat. I didn't even look at a man. I promise you, like an angel popped before me and said, you're going to have God's child. Joseph's like, yeah, right. Where's the guy? I want to kill him. And by the way, you're dead to me. Right? Think about this. This doesn't happen every day. Sure. Sure, he did. Sure, God did that. See, Joseph didn't know what was going on, and life just hit him with a curveball. But he responded so differently than most. He was going to leave her, but he still didn't want to shame her. Wow, is that different? What do we usually want to do? Revenge. Oh, I want to gossip about them so badly right now. Facebook, Insta, Twitter blowing up. Guess what my fiance did? Right? He didn't do that because he still had God's heart. But see, this is what's cool. God knew what Joseph was contemplating with, and he just knew that Joseph didn't know the whole story yet. So God sent Joseph an angel in. Listen in Matthew 1. It says, "But as Joseph was thinking about this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. The angel said, 'Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid.'" There's that word, that phrase again, circle it. "Don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. The baby inside her is from the Holy Spirit." I.e., she didn't cheat on you, right? She's going to have a son. You must give him the name Jesus. That's because he will save his people from their sins. How would Joseph respond to this? Could this really be God? It just didn't add up. It wasn't the norm. Was it really God talking to him? Was it bad pizza? Did Mary play like a Jedi mind trick on him? Speaking of the Jedi, who's looking forward to the new Star Wars movie? Let's give a shout out. Come on. Come on, we're Obi-Wan. We represent. It's like you talk Wookiee in here. You're part of Obi-Wan. Come on now. Yes, or Baby Yoda, whatever Yoda, Wookiee, Han Solo, whatever you speak, you're a part. And even if you don't, we'll love you anyways. Just teasing. Let's discover how he would respond to this curveball. This was huge, guys. Matthew 1, Joseph woke up and said, "Heck no, God." Is that what it says? Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded him to do. He took Mary home as his wife. Number two, if you're going to be someone that snaps out of the daze, I'm not saying it's always easy, but simply follow his plan. Follow his plan. He did exactly what he was told. He could have said, "There's no way that this is true." Even if he thought it was true, he could have been like, "That's not my child. That's not my responsibility. God, thank you, but find someone else, please." I wasn't planning on having a child right away. Right? He could have thought, "This is going to be too hard. This isn't in my plan. Us men, we like to plan. This isn't in it. Thanks, God." Do you know why Joseph could do this? It's easy. It's simple, but it's hard to do. He trusted God. He trusted God. When life hits, it can bring confusion, and confusion can put us in a deep daze. That said, during times of confusion, we have to still find a way to follow his plan. Now, I realize that it doesn't always say in Scripture, "Hey, at 1:35 p.m. on Wednesday, when you get hit with a curveball, this is what you do." I get that it doesn't say that in the Bible. However, that said, we do know certain things that God tells us, don't we? And if we don't, I'm about to share them with you, and you'll know now. We do know that he says things like this: "Trust me when things don't go well. I still have a plan for your life." He asks us to persevere when things get bad. Stay faithful. He asks us to forgive when others have wronged us. When it's not the curveball that we've done to ourselves, but someone threw it at us. He asks us to stick through difficult seasons with our spouse. He asks us to live with integrity when it would be easier not to. He asks us to be patient when we haven't seen the outcome that we want to see. And if we don't see the outcome we want to see, he asks us to trust him with the outcome that he sees. He asks us to have faith even during seasons of doubt, which we all have at times. See, God doesn't have an exact formula, so I'm not trying to put God in a box, but sometimes when God sees us doing the general things we know to do from the Bible, he'll come along specifically and reveal what he wants. Okay, you've trusted me, you've followed me, here's a clear path now for you. You want to snap out of the daze? Follow his plan, even through difficult seasons. Let's go back to Mary's story again. Let's see how Mary would respond to the angel's message. I love the humanness that's in the Bible too. Look what it says in Luke 1. Mary said to the angel, "But how? I've never slept with a man." Right? Gabriel was talking about, you know, who Jesus would be and what he would do. And the Mary's like, "Whoa, whoa, 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 hold the phone. Let's get back to square one here. I don't know if you know this, but I'm a virgin. This can't happen." Now, this might be shocking for some. I know I'm going to shock some of you, but back 2,000 years ago, you had to have sex to put a baby in here, right? So that's what Mary's thinking. How can this happen? How can this happen? I know I brought shock to you, but pray about it. But seriously, put yourself in Mary's shoes. And pretend that you've never heard this story if you've heard it before. You do the math. Nobody ever, and I mean ever, before her had a baby without doing the deed. Right? Not only that, could you imagine what she was thinking? In Mary's culture, this would have sealed her fate, especially if they found out that it wasn't Joseph's baby. Mary didn't even know how he was going to respond either. On top of all of that, hey, I know you weren't expecting it because you're still a virgin, but you're going to have a kid. Us parents know that responsibility even when we are a little prepared for it, right? And on top of all the normal responsibilities, you're parenting the Son of God. This is nuts. Hey, he's going to save the world. Make sure nothing happens to him. Right? Right? Am I right? Hey, he's perfect. You're not. Good luck parenting him. You know, there's not too many YouTube videos out there on how to raise the Son of God. Good luck. Right? What would Gabriel's response be to Mary when she said this? Like, a good point. God, how are you going to do this? No, he didn't do that, of course. But Gabriel explained how this was going to happen, and we're going to look at the last part of his response, and it says this in Luke 1. Some of you might want to circle it or underline it on your cell phone. Nothing you see is impossible with God. Amen. Nothing. Nothing we see is impossible with God. Number three, if you're going to be someone that snaps out of the daze so that you can prepare for what Jesus wants to do in you, look for the possibilities. Look for the possibilities. Not only was this a declaration for Mary, it's for you too. And can I ask this question? And I really want you to hone in on it for a moment. Do you really believe that nothing is impossible with God? See, when someone has experienced too many discouragements, too many disappointments, too many curveballs thrown their way, here's what can happen. They keep going, but they stop expecting. And don't hear this wrong. There is a season to just say, you know what? I'm going to put my head down and I'm going to work. But that shouldn't turn into a lifestyle, because we need to still look around and expect that God can still do things. Even if they do believe, maybe they're thinking, well, maybe that's true, but I can't have good things. Everyone, don't close your eyes, but actually put your head down. And just focus on wherever your eyes landed. Again, you don't have to close your eyes. You're actually focusing on where your eyes landed right now. What do you see? See, if your head was always down, you'd only see one vantage point, and that vantage point would be the floor. Now look up and look around. Look up and look around. See, when you keep your head up, you can see more vantage points and you can see more possibilities. And this is what can happen to us spiritually. When we stop expecting, it's like our spiritual head and heart is down. You can keep going, but how are you supposed to keep looking for the possibilities that God has for you if your head is just down? Church, look for the possibilities. What's going on in your life right now? Because it's easy to say, yes, look for the possibilities. But what's going on in your life right now that seems impossible? That seems hopeless? Can I encourage you? Get your head up. Look for the possibilities, because nothing is impossible with God. The statement doesn't mean that things will automatically change overnight. It could, but it doesn't necessarily mean that Gabriel didn't announce and then pop, baby Jesus is out the next day. Mary still had to go through the process and the weight of pregnancy. But nothing is impossible with God. And I'd encourage you to imply that and to believe that for your situation today. And here's another thing it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that God is a genie in the bottle and like I will get it the way I want and in my time. Again, it's about following his plan, not about him following our plan, right? But that said, nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. Maybe your marriage is in a daze. He can give you a fresh start during this Christmas season. Are you looking for the possibilities? Or is your only vantage point the marriage floor? This is how it's going to stay. Maybe your career has taken a turn for the worse. He can give you the smarts to turn that thing around. Maybe your financial situation has you in a deep, dark daze. He can turn that situation around. Are you looking or is your head down? Maybe a relationship you have isn't where you think it should be, and it's been going on for years. And so you've just been in a daze in this relationship because it just keeps going and going. He can still restore it. He can still turn it around. Are you looking or is your head down? Maybe you're in a daze spiritually and your faith is weak. I'm so glad that you're here. We're here for people on all faith levels, whether you have no faith or you're the strongest Christ follower that ever lived. I'm so glad that you're here. There's no embarrassment about having a weak faith at times. We all have weak faith at times. But maybe you're in a daze where your faith is weak. He can strengthen it. Are you looking for those possibilities, or do you just believe the spiritual funk and your head is down on the spiritual floor? As the worship team comes back to the front, guys, I just want you to hear this. If God can make a baby with a virgin, he can do amazing things for you as well. And that's one of the awesome reminders about what Christmas should mean to us. That God can come into any situation and bring something impossible. Mary didn't know that an angel was coming. Okay, I'll just kind of wait for the angel while I'm cooking. She didn't know. And then boom, all of a sudden, miracle. You want to snap out of the daze? Look for the possibilities and believe again. And if it doesn't happen tomorrow, pray again. And if it takes a while, follow his plan. How would your life change if you refused to let fear take over? I chose my words carefully. Notice I said take over. We're all going to fear at times. Every single one of us. Every single one of us are going to fear at times. But let's refuse to let it take over. Let's refuse to let it take over. Why? Because God is with us. He's here on this battle with us. Where would life take you if you followed His plan, even through difficult and unknown seasons? Would you see some amazing things happen again in your life and in the lives of others if you believe again and look for the possibilities? Why don't we close, heads bowed, eyes closed. You know, in a couple minutes, you're going to go out into this awesome, crazy world. And so it's so important that we take a moment or two to reflect on what God wants to say. What does He want to say to you? See, I don't know where you're at, but He does. And if you're doing great, still trust Him. If you're doing okay, maybe it's not good or bad, trust Him. But if you're in the days, you can trust Him too. He's with you in it. He's guiding you through it. So between you and God, just for a moment before I close off this part in prayer, just take 15 to 30 seconds. Let Him talk to you. Say something to Him. God, I am scared. Help me. I don't know what to do. Show me something. God, my head's been down for so long. It's like I've been living in a trance. Help me to look again. Help me to believe again. Lord, I pray for all my friends in the room. Thank you for this Christmas story reminder that you're truly with us. Whether we're doing well or in our darkest days, you're with us. And I pray that you would show yourself faithful and real to every single person in this room, whatever they're going through, wherever they're at. And some of you might even want to add something like this to your prayer. God, I didn't know that this was what it was about. I thought you were just out to get me. You're actually out to help me. You're actually here to help me out of the darkness. I've been in a daze my whole life, but today I choose you as forgiver and leader. I know that it won't be perfect. I still know I'll have my seasons, but I at least have you by my side now. And I ask you to be by my side. Be my leader. Be my forgiver. It's you and me now. For all my friends in the room, show us on greater levels how much you care and how much you truly are with us every single step of the way. We love you, Jesus. Thank you.